another episode of the So-Called Oreos podcast. I'm Kia Swinton here with
Amari Pollard,
Janae Price,
Rachel Fowler.
And okay, let's get right into it with this week in Black history. Okay, so August 13th, 1881, the first African-American nursing school opened at Spelman College in Atlanta, Georgia.
Spelman.
HBCU. I believe that's an all-women's college.
It is.
Okay, glad
it's
I got
the
that
black
right.
women mecca of colleges.
Yeah.
Is that the one next to Morehouse?
Yes.
Yeah. I don't know why my ass didn't go to Spelman.
I know.
Yeah, I regret not going to HBCU.
I would have been married by now.
I'm not going to an all-women's college. Sorry.
Yeah, that was my hang-up. It was kind of like, oh, should I aim for that? And I was like, honestly, do I want to go to an... Although, Morehouse...
It's Morehouse right there.
Right. Yeah.
They're essentially really close, together.
But still, I don't want to do that. I want to have men in my classes.
Yeah. I screwed myself over because all the men in communication class are gay. So...
I was going to say they were dumb. Although, I'm sorry.
Oh, well, that's
I had the most interesting conversations in college with the women. Like, why were the men even there? They didn't even talk.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind going to an all-women school.
Especially if it's an all-women's black school. Yeah. I would be really excited.
Man. You have so much friends.
I want dudes in my class. That's it. That's it.
For you.
Sorry to interrupt you.
Gucci. We're going to have an episode about HBCUs and PWIs.
Yep.
Later. Okay. So August 16th, 1961, on sale this day was a stamp designed to commemorate the 100th anniversary the Emancipation Proclamation. It was designed by George Olden, which made him the first black to design a U.S. postage stamp. So, like, all those stamps we have, like, black people, started in August, actually, I think, 1942, and they do it, like, a bunch, so, like, they let black people design that. Pretty cool.
Fun.
Yeah. On to you, Amari.
Okay, yes. So this week on Black Professionals We Love, I want to highlight a French visual artist who I am obsessed with on Instagram. I randomly stumbled upon her like a year or so ago, and she's kind of blowing up right now. Her name is, sorry if I butcher it, Aurelia Durand, and her work focuses on presenting the beauty that is the black body in all its color and movement, and like her illustrations actually move. So that's pretty cool. And she says her goal is to work with brands to show representation matters by creating illustrations for books, magazine covers, animations, editorials, and more. She recently just finished up a campaign with Facebook. Before that, it was Giphy. Before that, was it Califia Farms? I don't think I said that right. Anyways, please do yourself a favor and follow her. Her art is amazing. And her handle on Instagram is at, I'm just going to say the numbers and letters, is 4URLIA. So it's Aurelia with like the 4 and then 3. But yes, go follow her. That's it.
Okay.
So this week we are talking about music.
Yeah.
And I think this topic is we all have very eclectic and different tastes. Mm-hmm. And I think it's interesting coming from, you know, being black people assume we listen to R&B.
Rap,
hip-hop. I think people usually associate dance hall and reggae too with mm-hmm. black people, but like
specifically Caribbean.
Yes, but a lot of white people can't tell. So, right. But yeah, so like how has like music played a role in your lives, and like what were you guys like listening? Like what were the hot tunes like when you guys were growing up? Like what are the kids listening to? Like what's a hot beat?
Okay, Mean Girls.
Yes. Okay, yeah, I'm glad you got it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Growing up, I listened to rap and hip hop, and that was like all I listened to. And then I will never ever forget another summer spent at my grandma's house. And you know how that MTV morning show would play where they would just play music videos?
Yeah, they did that on VH1 too.
Yeah. I watched MTV. I think maybe we clicked back and forth between MTV and VH1 probably.
They're only one channel away.
But exactly. But Sugar We're Going Down by
Fall Out Boy.
By Fall Out Boy would play every morning.
That music
video
used to creep me the hell out.
I loved
that
it.
That moose.
I loved it.
You say it's sick.
I absolutely adored it.
The song is like...
The song is amazing. So from then, I started listening to Fall Out Boy. Like, I went on a deep dive, listened to all their albums, and I was like stuck. And then I started listening to like Paramore and Mayday Parade and like all these different alternative pop punk bands. And next thing you know, I was like wearing all black and Chucks and stuff and trying to be a scene kid. So that was my early music experience as an Oreo.
Mine's like similar, but you can go.
No, I was gonna say, I think it's funny because like I'm still a very big Paramore fan. Janae and I just saw Paramore last summer.
Yeah.
And that was the second time I had seen them. And it's funny because my sister had introduced me to Paramore. And then like she got out of the Paramore phase and I just like went deeper into it. And then she turned on me and was like, oh my God, Amari, you're like so white. Like all you do is listen to white people music. I'm like, chick, you're the one who turned me on. But yeah, Paramore, Fall Out Boy, I'm obsessed with. They're more recent, like the 1975, but I discovered them my freshman year in college. I saw them live and I don't care what he looks like. I want to marry Maddie.
I don't even know who this is.
Look,
1975 is pretty good.
They're pretty good. But I think I was also like I grew up in a Caribbean household. So like between old school reggae music, dance hall, but also my parents were the product of, when they were my age, they were like in the 80s, mm-hmm. like late 80s, early 90s. And so that music was very influential. And I'm also like I'm very interested in vintage things. So like whether that's physical vintage things, but like also vintage music. So I would love Sam Cooke, Otis Redding, Ella Fitzgerald, like all these different older songs. So like I'm all over the place and I don't make sense to people. So
same. Growing up, I didn't listen to a lot of hip hop and R&B as well. Like my parents are also from the Caribbean. And when they came here to the U.S., it was like early 1980. So like whatever was popular at the time, that's what they were listening to. And that's what we listened to growing up. And I didn't mind that. I actually
liked it.
I actually liked the music they were listening to, like Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston. Like soft 80s, 90s rock. Like I enjoyed all of it. And like now as an adult, I still enjoy listening to those music. Mm-hmm. Sade.
Who else? Sweetest Taboo. Didn't you say you had like a Jonas Brothers?
I can talk about that.
Didn't you guys have a thing?
I'm not ashamed. Oh, yeah. I will say yes in high school.
I'll talk about mine after.
Yeah, I love the Jonas Brothers in like
high school. They're still popping.
Demi Lovato. Now I don't really like their music.
Yeah, their music sucks, but I'm still going to see them in August. Okay.
I will see them live because I feel like I realize they probably play.
Oh,
like
I have an extra ticket. Deadass, if you want to come.
I have
a ticket.
Kia, when is it?
It's August. Sorry. 20th something.
Where?
Oh, I'm sorry. Amari is leaving. No, it's in, I think, Madison Square Garden. My best friend in middle school, we were obsessed with the Jonas Brothers, and she was like, bitch, I got 3 tickets for me, her, and another girl, but the other girl can't come, so we literally have another ticket.
I will definitely join you guys.
Okay. Cool. But, I'll send you the info when I figure out what it is.
I will. Well, I'll see you guys soon.
Hey! But were you... I'll let you finish.
That's basically it. Like, high school, Demi Lovato, the Jonas Brothers.
Demi Lovato was a mood.
She...
what was that one song? There was a La La Land.
I love Lala fan.
That was the song.
I went through all those phases. When I was like, I would be like in my room in the dark, just like doing my homework, like, I wish someone loved me. Did you forget?
I'm like, who am I singing to? Because I'm single as fuck. Who broke my heart?
I know. It made you feel it.
And you're just like imagining it and you're like, literally, I have not had my first kiss.
Right. I'm just sad because you're sad, Demi.
Right.
Kia, what was your experience?
So music is pretty interesting. I think music affects like the way, like you guys said, what your parents are listening to. Mm-hmm. So like growing up, I listened to a lot of TLC, a lot of Michael Jackson, like older stuff like that, a lot of Motown, because that was like my grandparents' favorite was like Motown. And so I listened to a lot of that stuff and not really a lot of like, I want to say just music from white people growing up, but like, it was a lot of like old... hip hop. My dad would play like, what was this song? Wow, I'm forgetting the name, but it's Christmas time in Hollis, Queens. You know that song?
Yeah.
So just like a lot of like old like original hip hop and rap from my dad, and then TLC and like Michael Jackson and Motown. So all of that, and then. I grew up like listening to like 3LW was like when I was younger.
3LW.
Yeah.
People don't know that the Cheetah Girl the Cheetah Girl
was
Keely and Adrian were part of 3LW.
Who doesn't know that?
With a lot of people
power.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so power 3LW. Group. But that's because I'm gonna say that's because I grew up with the 3LW stage, I grew up in the suburbs where everyone, I went to a private school with everyone was black except like two people. So then when I moved
to... The private school was all black?
Yeah.
Wow.
So it was like 13 of us. It was like a new private school.
Either way.
Yeah. Yeah. So I grew up like thinking like, okay, that everyone listens to 3LW, well, whatever. Normal. Yeah. So then I went to, when I moved to Washington, New Jersey, like the middle of nowhere near Pennsylvania, a lot of that, like I realized that a lot of people didn't listen to the same music I listened to growing up. Cause like obviously white people probably, I'm not going to guess, but I'm just saying, maybe they let their kids listen to rock or like, Queen and Rolling Stone and stuff like that. So it's a little different. So that's what they were into, like more rock and stuff like that. And so I didn't really know about these things, but I wanted to like kind of like fit in like the Oreo experience and like see what people were listening to. So I remember like Avril Lavigne was a big thing in third grade.
So, she's a mood too.
Like, yeah. I was just like, yeah, I would just be like, okay, my friend, this is what my friend listens to. I'm going to listen to this too. So I would listen to Avril Lavigne. And then I would listen to like, yeah, like Fall Out Boy. A lot of my people like I was playing basketball with listened to a lot of like punk, like Fall Out Boy, Paramore, stuff like
Green
that.
So, Day.
Yeah, Green Day. So I was, they were obsessed with Green Day. So I would start listening to that type of stuff. And then I would say like middle school, high school, I was really big in the Jonas Brothers. I remember the day I saw Nick Jonas' face, and guys, I swear to God, it was like a movie. I like was in my room.
Wait, is this, wait, oh, okay. No, I'm thinking she's saying like she saw him in person. She's no, this chick just in her bedroom.
I saw him in person one day and I was shocked.
When I remember me and my sister were just watching, like, you remember like Disney Channel commercials, they would play like
the music, video.
The music videos.
Yeah.
So I, yep, so I saw... Year 3000, I swear to God, I looked and I was like,
that song took the world onto the Jonas Brothers.
Yeah, never that heard song, it. That music video.
What? You're lying. You're lying. We got this.
I never paid attention to the Jonas Brothers because I was a little punk girl and I was like, everything that's girly and blah, 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 I'm just going to ignore it.
That song is going to go down like that today.
I'll play it for you after, but Nick Jonas, I saw him.
Disrespect.
And I was like, oh my God, this is my, like, that was my first teenage crush.
My bae.
Yeah. And I know people who know me know, like, right now and for the last 5 years, my celebrity diehard is The Weeknd, Abel Tesfaye, and Bruno Mars. But my people think I'm crazy when it comes to them. I am.
No,
but when. You don't know me, Rachel.
Rachel loves Bruno Mars.
I love me some Bruno Mars. The Weeknd can go.
No, not because I like them, but the way I am about them. Mm-hmm. Like, I've seen The Weeknd 5 times. Like, wow. I'm psycho obsessed with him. Like, I follow them day and night. But, like, originally before that, Nick Jonas was the original, like, fangirl crush. So I literally would, every time I saw a Nick Jonas picture, I would cut it out and put it in this folder. I really thought that, I swear to God, I thought I was marrying Nick Jonas. I would tell my friend, she was like, yeah. I'll give you $100 whenever you meet Nick Jonas. I was like, bet. You're I'm going to meet Nick Jonas, like, before I die.
No, did you? I was obsessed with Joe Jonas. At first I had a face with Joe, and then it was Nick. It was never Kevin. He was in there.
It was never Kevin, but Kevin's the one I met because I went to Montclair State with his sister-in-law.
Honestly, let's be honest. We probably know Kevin is probably the best human being of the three of them.
Probably.
Kevin looks like the most.
Well, that's why he has to be, because he's ugliest.
Yo,
let me just say something.
Watch the Jonas Brothers documentary on Amazon. If you guys were, I was like, who cares about Kevin? And I watched that, and I literally was like, Kevin is may not be the most outwardly talented as. Nick
and Joe
can't really sing or like do anything else.
We are spending so much time on the Jonas Brothers.
No, but it's important because like Kevin doesn't get enough like credit, and he's just a good human being.
Who are the Jonas Brothers?
Kia is the girl.
He probably is.
Oh, girl, I'm the Kia is.
No, did you guys watch the movie Stuck in the Suburbs on Disney Channel?
Yes.
Kia is those two girls.
Wait, he's running in the suburbs.
Running after the superstar.
But you know, I've been psycho with him.
They found his phone.
They found his phone. They were blackmailing him.
I really thought, like, deadass, I thought like Jonas Brothers was my life, and then I went into like this phase with like Lady Gaga, and I was the biggest Lady Gaga stan. Like, no one could tell me. I was literally staying up learning every Lady Gaga dance move. I was originally Lady Gaga
doesn't even
stan.
Know her dance moves.
No, I'm not now.
She's talented.
I'm talking about when she first came out. Me right here, you can ask my mom. I did everything like Lady Gaga did. I was like 100% hardcore Lady Gaga fan.
Did you have her sunglasses, those thick black sunglasses?
Hell yeah, I did. I had everything
her
Lady Gaga.
in her fashion.
And my parents were like, you're weird. You're going through this weird white girl music phase. And I didn't care. I was like, no, this is what I love.
Lady Gaga got canceled when that blackface picture came up.
Oh, I didn't know that.
That's the minute she got canceled.
So what we have learned is
Kia goes really hard for the musical.
Yeah.
Kia, you that she loves.
Stan.
Yeah, people think like, no.
Tendencies.
Nick Jonas was the original Stan. Like, I Stan The Weeknd, like, it's disgusting. He's literally like a second god to me.
Honestly, that's the way that I'm feeling about BTS nowadays.
Oh, God.
See, that's weird.
Okay.
BTS also sounds like, can we like clear what BTS is? Because I also, isn't like BTS like a sex thing? Or is that not?
Wait, what is BTS stand
for? Oh, that's
for?
BD. Is it BD?
No, BDSM. Girl, yeah. What the hell?
What? No. BTS, I can't remember what it stands for, but it has like, it had one original meaning and then they like changed it.
Can you tell people what who BTS are?
Oh, BTS is a Korean pop group, a boy band,
K-pop.
They originally started out as they originally started off as a rap group, and then they like turned
into a rap group
because the original member RM was an underground rapper in Korea. And then the group was kind of founded around him. So it was RM, Suga, J-Hope,
who were
like...
Suga,
yes.
Janae made Virgil and I the other night.
She forced us.
Watch these dumb...
They weren't dumb. It was Monster X.
I'm not gonna lie. Aesthetically, the music video was very good compared to
these
American music videos.
Boys are talented.
No, I think what was... Talented. Okay, what was... Okay, yes. They're talented. I think... Janae was just trying to describe them to us, and she was she was just pointing out who she thinks is the most beautiful man, and he looks like a fairy to me.
Jimin.
He looks like a fairy.
They have very soft, feminine like features.
But see, this is a two layer thing, because number one, in Korea, it is way more acceptable for men to wear makeup
and plastic surgery. Okay,
in Korea, beauty is beauty; it does not have a gender. So, to enhance their looks, they put on makeup and they might wear chokers or dangly earrings. For them, it's just more so to enhance your look, not necessarily masculine or feminine, which I think is very, very interesting.
It is. That's cool. I'm just not going to be attracted to him.
No.
Nothing.
I am. And then like with my love for K-pop, it's kind of like I was talking to my parents about it because I was trying to show them videos too,
and my girl music.
Well, I guess Korean music.
They didn't even think that. They were basically like, "This is another culture taking from our culture." But I guess because a lot of their videos, you've got guys rapping and they're kind of doing, you know, SoundCloud rapper ad libs and dancing.
They have a song with
French Montana. They have a song.
What?
Well, that's Monsta X, not BTS.
They're
sorry.
Different, Rachel.
But they are. But BTS has BTS has a song with like Juice WRLD. Like, wow. BTS is the biggest K-pop group in the world.
I
want
to say they are the biggest fandom in the world.
Yes,
like, I am gonna make fun of you all the time for liking BTS, not because it's a black or white thing, just because I don't know what the hell they're
saying. It's not even a black or white thing.
No, I'm just saying because like, it's not like you're not black for listening to X, Y, and Z. That's what I'm saying. I'm not going to say that, but I'm going to make fun of you, whatever. But BTS, I do know, like, BTS fandom is crazy. Like, people were standing outside for like days when BTS came here, because it was like general admission. And I will say, the BTS fandom, I thought Justin Bieber had the biggest fan base. BTS is worldwide. BTS is crazy. The things they say worldwide on Twitter, like, y'all don't know, but like, BTS is literally psychos.
Their fan base is called Army. But to get to the cultural aspect of it, and the conversation that I was having with my parents is just kind of the idea that black culture is kind of transactional, and it's becoming transactional, where it's kind of like the music that we create, where it's like rock, rap,
country,
jazz,
which a lot of people
blues
don't give us credit for,
EDM. The music that we create becomes this worldwide currency, and black culture in general is currency now.
Everyone's
it's world currency,
off of it.
And to think that a black girl who lives in Brooklyn could fall in love with a K-pop group, a Korean group that uses so many references, dance moves, sounds that mimic black culture. It's like, it's crazy.
Do you think that's
about
an issue, or does it like not faze you?
I think
it's a little bit of an issue.
Yeah.
But like Janae is someone who like loves yeah. BTS yeah. whatever.
So I will definitely say that when I first started listening to it, I was like, this is interesting and I'm not sure how I feel about it, right? Mm-hmm. But then when I think about kind of the intersection between Black culture and Asian culture, we take from each other. When
what you do look we at, take from Asian
you
culture?
You look at Black rappers like Wu-Tang Clan, Kendrick Lamar calling himself Kung Fu Kenny, Nicki Minaj wearing
Nicki Minaj does too much.
Exactly. When you think about even Black exploitation films, when you have Black people in the 70s and on up being like Kung Fu fighters and stuff mm-hmm. like that. Black culture and Asian culture has this very interesting intersection. So a part of me is kind of like, we do definitely take from each other. But there is another part that wonders if these Korean rappers and artists know
the history, where
their style comes from, and if they respect it.
Yeah, because that's there's a difference between appreciation. I want to say, like, I don't know, I'm not going to say I'm an expert on this, but like, I feel like when Nicki Minaj does that stuff, it's like, I'm going to appreciate the like culture, like mm-hmm. the Asian culture, and a lot of these rappers, like, it's not meant from a place of like, I don't know the background of this,
and I'm gonna make money off it.
Yeah. I feel like a lot of times when people take from Black people, it's never like, I generally have a respect from Black people, and I generally love Black culture, and I want to appreciate, because even like a lot of these white people who are obsessed with Kanye, can they give a about Black people? Like, no, they don't. Or like even like Kendrick Lamar, and like when Kendrick Lamar had that thing with that girl that went up there and said the N-word, she didn't, like, you can tell like those, a lot of these people who are fans of rappers and Black artists,
that situation
stuff,
was a little, I think that situation itself was a little iffy.
That's that could be iffy, but I'm just saying, like, general, like, a lot of people who go to these rap you know, concerts and stuff, because I went to a Weeknd concert and I felt uncomfortable because this white girl was next to me and she was saying like the N-word sometimes, and like, I'm not about to fight you because I paid a lot of money here and that's my boyfriend, but like, I don't really think you have like an appreciation of like Black culture. I think you just like what you have, like a lot of people with like liking Beyonce, and when she came out and reminded all y'all that she was Black on Formation, a lot of white people went crazy, and, well, I just think it's a little different.
Well, I think my issue is not so much with like BTS having like exhibiting examples of like Black culture and that stuff. It's the way that people will respond to other cultures taking on Black culture versus the way they respond to Black people owning their own culture. It's very different. Like, BTS can do that and they can be welcomed and stuff, but then other artists do the same thing and it's just a different reaction. Just like the same thing with Black physical features, a big butt and curves and a chest was not appreciated until it landed on the body of Kim Kardashian mm-hmm. and her sisters. So it's just like my issue is always with the response of other people.
To quickly defend BTS, not because I'm a BTS stan. It's going to sound like it's because I am. But anyway, I have not seen the synchronization or the attention to detail in boy groups. Like, if we want to say Pretty Ricky, for example, which I know it's kind of hard to compare, like, boy groups in the past to boy groups now, because there aren't really any Black boy groups, are there right now?
I wouldn't say.
Not now.
Like,
no.
B2K was like the last one.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But like, if I were to just compare like the way BTS or Monsta X goes about their performance, their choreography, and their musicality, it is a lot more in depth. Like, a BTS performance is similar to Beyonce's performance.
It is. Where they're dancing. Korea, that's the culture.
Exactly.
Like, practice every day, and they do a lot. I will say, like, that is something true about,
and
like,
that's why
pop group.
I respect them so much, because it's like, that's why I respect Beyonce, because Beyonce is doing these complicated dance routines. She is singing at the same time and wearing heels, and it's like, you've got these guys and it's eight guys who are perfectly synchronized. They're singing and doing these complicated dance moves. That's why I respect them. But it definitely is always a thought of like, if it was a group of Black men that were doing the same thing as them, would they get the same recognition?
I don't think internationally. Hell no. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Hell no.
Even if they were around, because BTS has been around since like 2013, 2014. And if I do wonder if there was a Black group that had been around from 2013 to 2014, making the same type of music, doing the same type of dances, that was just as good. I do really wonder if people in China would be like, oh my God, you know?
I don't think so.
I do wonder.
And I think like a good point of like this relating to like the title of the podcast of like music, of like being told like that you listen to white people music or whatever, which I've gotten that so many times that I'm just like, whatever, I'm still gonna like what I like. And I just think that, I know people are joking and stuff, but like we just have to be careful with that, because white people music is like originated from black people. Like we said, black people have very large influences in like country music and obviously hip hop and rap,
which is ironic. Influences rock. Black people created
exactly,
and but it's ironic when you think about it now, because there's a whole hoopla about
Lil Nas
trying to get on the country, and then he got Billy Ray Cyrus on, and they're still like, nah, you're not really, mm-hmm. this isn't really country. I don't hear anything else but country in there.
No one talked about Taylor Swift when she was doing pop.
Well, no, people did. Country. People did talk,
but
not.
But it wasn't.
She didn't get on the award show. Yeah. She was not
right.
She was doing
like Red and like whatever, and she was clearly 100% pop. And mm-hmm. they would still give her every country award. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then with this, Lil Nas X was actually like really disappointing, because it's like, it's clearly country. And you guys, Billboard deliberately took it off because they got responses of white people hating it.
And I was just actually reading a podcast the other day, and I think actually Billboard, like the top Billboard top music, was started by a black man.
Wow, that doesn't surprise me.
Which is ironic. But
not even on the country charts. Lil Nas X has the longest running number one hit, and he beat Taylor Swift.
But I think there's a little bit of time before the Grammys, but I think he's gonna get a Grammy. I think he's gonna get it outside of country, but I think he might get it in country.
It's just a little disappointing because he says like, what does he say about Wrangler or whatever, and people are boycotting Wrangler. Yeah. Like white people were boycotting. I think it was Wrangler. Like
people were burning their Wranglers.
That's how racist like people country fans are, which is ironic because it's like country was like created by black people, and it's like we can't even like have our own music. And like even like Beyonce on Lemonade has that country song. I'm forgetting the name of it, but she has a song that's like inspired heavily by country. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. I'm trying to name
because she has like her family's from the south.
Daddy's lessons.
I'm like curious for you guys. I mean, like, I don't know if I necessarily was aware of it growing up. I think like now in retrospect, I think what I did with like my musical taste was that I tried to expand my taste beyond everything that was R&B mm-hmm. and hip hop and rap, because I just didn't want people to put me in a box and be like, oh, if you're black, like this is what you listen to. Mm-hmm. So like, I'm gonna listen to everything you don't expect me to listen to, and then like hopefully that like some kind of acceptance will come with that. And then it was funny because even after people knew my musical taste, like I had an incident with like my lacrosse coach. I might have mentioned this before. It was where like we had karaoke night, and on the bus when we were traveling, she's like, Amari, like come up and like do one of your rap songs for us.
Oh my God.
And I'm like, and everyone just stopped and looked at me, and I'm like, wow, y'all know I don't listen to rap. Y'all know my musical taste, and no one said anything. People privately came up to me and were like, are you okay? And she did it multiple times. She multiple times mentioned my non-existent love for rap and hip hop music because I was black.
Yeah. I guess I never personally, it was definitely a thought that this is what people expected from me. But during the time where I was like really in love with punk music, the music was just so important to me that for me, it was like race didn't matter. It was mostly my family making those comments.
You're not thinking about it when you're listening to music. You like what you like.
Exactly. And that's kind of how I was. It was my family making those comments like, oh, you're listening to
white people
music. And I started listening to a little bit of screamo too. And they're like, this is devil's music or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I was just kind of like, whatever, y'all, I'm listening to what I want to listen to. Like, mm-hmm. this is important. I'm angsty I had no reason to be angsty, but yet was still angsty. And I was just kind of like, this speaks to me. I'm going to listen to it.
I got a whole hell of reasons to be angsty. I think it was funny because like I'm listening, you notice like a certain pattern with certain music. Like I was very much into Paramore because I was freaking depressed. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the songs, more so their more recent albums, talks about depression very very outwardly, but it's also kind of masked behind this really bubbly beat. And I love that because I don't know why I smile a lot. And it's just a reflex, so people automatically assume that I'm a happy person, and I actually skew more sad than I do happy. And I think that's like kind of why I like related to that music. But like, I'm curious, Rachel, like for you, how like music played out in your family, and like if people comment. You said like you kind of just listen to what your parents listen to, but like
I listen to what my parents listen to. So like music was really big in like my neighborhood in Queens. So like I didn't know what the latest artist that came out, the latest song. I like pretended I knew just to like be a part of those conversations,
right.
But like in reality, I had no idea. And even for me expressing like, yeah, like the Eagles or Michael Jackson or Whitney Houston, like they would just it was the my peers were not listening to those artists, so it was just like, oh, you listen to like old people music,
right?
That's the comments that I would get from that. So mm-hmm. I usually kept my musical preferences to like myself, but like going home,
which is weird because music is a very expressive,
yeah,
it's like an expressive experience,
right? And for not to be like outward about that, it's kind of like you know, just keep it to myself.
I think it's, we didn't like talk about this, but I'm curious about you guys. Is like, not only was it the experience of listening to music, but like actually playing music. Like in my household, my mom, from when I was like 5, made me get into piano lessons. Me and my sister both played the violin well into high school. Mm-hmm. And like my, even though my parents weren't playing instruments, we regularly and still regularly karaoke together.
I played the clarinet and violin.
I played the clarinet as well.
In elementary and middle school. And it was fun. I enjoyed it.
Yeah. I think my mom, I know she's probably going to be sad when she listens to this because she wishes I still played the violin. But my mom used to be so proud of me being the only black girl playing a violin on the stage. She just thought there was like something so beautiful. Now every time she sees a black violinist, she's like, Amari.
Do you guys ever see the black violin group? I think I always see it a lot when I was commuting to Brooklyn for work, but it was on the 14th Street.
I have seen them.
They're so amazing. It's so beautiful. It's like a group of black violinists.
Yeah.
And it's literally so beautiful.
Or like, I was so glad when the royal wedding happened and they had a black cellist and I think he was like 17 or something. And the cello is my favorite instrument. And it was just the most beautiful thing. I'm like, yes, y'all think black people are rough and angry, but look at the way that black boy is caressing the music out of that cello.
That's actually a good point. Like, it's like something that's not associated with like black people being hard and tough.
Yeah, but it takes a lot of tender care.
Yeah, I didn't think about that.
We also enjoy classical music.
Right. Yeah. I love classical music. Beethoven.
Mm-hmm. And also Regina Carter is a great black violinist.
Ooh. And like what you said, but like you want people to think like you're not just like in this one bubble of like listening rap and hip hop. I feel like that's similar to me because like also a big influence was I did radio in college and it was like an underground station. So like my show was the only, like one of like two or three like hip hop based shows. Mm-hmm. And we could only play like old music or like rock. It's like a completely rock station. So I was like really different and like the only black, like maybe like 3 of us were black on the radio station, and I would play like a lot of like old school rap and hip hop and stuff. And then I was like, oh, I want to like diversify this and play like newer stuff. And then I don't know, I just like love music. So I feel like if you look at my playlist, you could see like whatever type of music I'm listening to. And now I'm really into EDM, and I've had this conversation recently with someone about like how like going to like an EDM concert, and I've recently like wanted to go to the Zed concert, and like I could find no one to go with me.
I would love to go to Zed.
Oh really? Now
yeah,
I know.
I like love Zed, but also I'm curious how he does it because it's always someone else singing and featuring. Like I know you can just play it, but it's like I want you to have all the people who are featured on your songs like there in person. No, but I would totally go see Zed.
Oh my god, because I was trying to like find someone to go to Zed.
Zed is like the king of summer songs.
Yeah, and no one, all my friends were kind of saying no because none of my friends are in EDM, and I particularly like kind of want to go with a black person, and like only like one like kind of said yes, but like I couldn't go. And I was talking to someone about like the experience of like liking EDM as black, and like how like you're kind of like one of the only like couple like black people in the concert and stuff like that, because I've seen like Skrillex and other places, but I'm like, wow, I really want to experience that, but like I don't want to feel like a complete outsider.
But
like,
I think that's funny too, because I went to go see Childish Gambino with my friend Chris, and we were there and we were like, where are the black people?
Oh, that doesn't surprise me.
It wasn't surprising, but I think because like it was different. You know, when you listen to an artist by yourself in your room and you're not necessarily aware of like their fan base and like you're listening to their songs.
Gambino
like,
and Chance the Rapper are the non-threatening black men of hip hop.
I'm gonna like say 100%.
But like they're like, I mean, like I feel like as like a nerdy black girl, I can like relate to them. Like, well, not mostly Childish Gambino, where he's like, I'm kind of like a nerdy black guy. And like, if I was going to make music, I don't think it would sound like him, but it might be a little bit might be a little surprising to people. I don't know.
I think it's the same with like, what if you went to a Kanye concert now? I feel like it would be a bunch of white people. I disagree. I 100%
agree. Let's not get into Kanye.
Yeah, let's
step away from Kanye.
I just think it would be similar.
Let's step back.
It'll be similar. That's all I'm saying.
But I mean, like, I feel like this episode could go on forever. Music is just like important to so many, just the culture in our lives. And
listen
and stuff,
to what you want to listen to. Yes, even though people call white people music.
But like, or old people music.
Listen. Like, old people can get down too. Like, I'm all the old people at my wedding, if I get married, it probably won't be a wedding, will be like a civil ceremony, if anything. But like, we'll be getting down to all the old music.
Yeah.
But like, tell us what your favorite bands are. I need to discover some new people. Like, I've been listening to a lot of like Carly Rae Jepsen lately for whatever reason.
I heard she banged. She was great.
She's good. Like, I was listening to on the way here. So like, tell us your recommendations. We want to hear.
But Rachel, you had some words for us?
You did.
Yes. Okay. So on this segment of Time to Talk Mental Health, I want to discuss music therapy.
Oh.
What a coincidence. The Association of Music Therapy defines music therapy as the clinical and evidence-based use of music interventions to accomplish individualized goals within a therapeutic relationship by a credentialed professional. Music therapy is used to address physical, emotional, cognitive, and social needs of individuals. It has also been successfully used to help patients of general stress, cancer, high blood pressure, and more. So if you're wondering how does it work, music therapy touches all aspects of the mind, body, brain, and behavior. Music can provide a distraction for the mind. It can alter our mood, which can influence behavior. Even though I highly recommend speaking to a mental health counselor about your issues, music therapy can be another form of therapy to help with your mental health. Don't give up on the process of healing. Find what works for you, and it may be an array of things. Moving my body, talking to a therapist, cooking, and listening to music are ways I help deal with my mental health. Do your research, ask questions, and don't be afraid to try something new. Before I end, I want to let everyone know that July is Minority Mental Health Month. That's a wrap on this segment of Mental Health. Take care.
So, in a word of advice, we had another friend write in, share her experience. It was really, really similar to all of ours. She said that she lived in Atlanta and was about 17 or 18 years old, and she was hanging out with some neighbors in her like apartment complex they were living in at the time. And they said the topic, or she was talking about music with them. And both of the girls that she was with were talking a lot about hip hop. And she basically mentioned liking Sum 41, Disturbed, Marilyn Monroe. Wow. Marilyn Manson. Wow.
I was like, I didn't know Marilyn Monroe was a singer.
It's been a long day, y'all. And the Foo Fighters. And she said the black girl looked at her like she had three heads. And she was really confused because she's like, what's wrong with my music taste? And sorry, gotta clear this up, that she was in hanging out with a black girl and a white girl. And the black girl looked at her as if she was crazy and was basically like, that's satanic music. Mm-hmm. Like, you're disturbed. Why are you listening to satanic music? And she said the white girl also looked at her like she was crazy. Like, what is your problem? And she said that it was really awkward. She tried to explain how rock isn't just for white people and how it's not satanic. But she said that everyone was convinced from then on out that she was just trying to be a white girl and that she was weird and disturbed. So.
Mm-hmm. Looks like we've all experienced that.
Yeah. Yeah, I would say not as dramatically as people thinking that I was weird or disturbed, but it was just a basic of, like, you're white.
I think that's an older mindset of, like, you're just, like, whatever is, like, rock and screamo is, like, just Satan.
Yeah,
and, like, I agree. I remember, like, I wanted to paint my nails, like, black because, like, all the white girls did it and, like, Lady Gaga and stuff like that. And then my mom was like, absolutely not. And, like, my grandma was like, no, that's That's devil stuff.
I remember my mom asked me at one point, because I was constantly wearing black and I had painted my nails black, and I would always wear like these huge headphones and I'd just be listening to rock music all the time. And my mom one time was like, "You can tell me. Are you gothic?" And I was like, "No, mom, I'm
Don't
not.
Be one of those goths.
So
now.
Dramatic. Yeah,
I was like, "No, I'm not gothic. I'm doing well. I'm happy.
Are you possessed?"
Yeah. But I think kind of like on the like appearance, like worrying, like wondering about like your musical taste, but like more so like musical music therapy. Mm-hmm. To go back to Rachel, I just wanted to share this cute story because I think it's just cute. But I was going through like a really hard time and my sophomore year in high school, and I guess it was more apparent than I had thought. Like my parents and my sister, I guess, noticed. And I remember one time it was just me and my dad driving from like a tennis match or something, and he's like, "I've just like noticed you're very down." And what does this man do? But he puts on Katy Perry's Firework, and he's like, I think of you every time I hear this song, and I just want you to remember that like you're a special human being." And so he just like,
that's so cute.
He didn't say anything, he just like played that for me. That's so like sweet.
Did you cry in the passenger seat?
I was like, why is he so sweet and kind? I think like I was like, he really loves me. But so like now when I'm down, it's like very corny, I'll like listen to that song, even though it's like a really it's a bad song. But yeah, so like I think music has the power to heal, but to like also for people to express certain things to you that they may not be able to say in words fully. Mm-hmm. But yeah,
definitely.
Okay. Well, thanks guys for tuning into this week's episode. Just a little heads up, the next episode of So-Called Oreos will be released on September 24th. So until next time, please follow us on all social media at So-Called Oreos, and you can email us at socalledoreos@gmail.com. And you can listen to us on SoundCloud, iTunes, Spotify, Google Play, and please remember to like, rate, subscribe, and leave a review. Until then, bye!